Well, they're building a gallows outside my cell, and I've got 25 minutes to go, and the whole town's waiting just to hear me yell. I got 24 minutes to go. Well, they gave me some beans for my last meal, but 23 minutes to go.
I don't think you'll be surprised to learn this morning that we are going to talk about Brexit, inevitably. It is, of course, with the diluting effects of COVID, it is the only story in town. It's on every single front page. Even the Daily Star appears to have gone down the Brexit line, although rather typically at the moment they come out with a very good gag that twists at the end. But it's so bizarre, isn't it? It's so bizarre, and I am very conscious of how much money may be making its way to the Hospice UK charity today, because I have to give them £10 every time I say the words, "I told you so," in the context of Brexit. But we'll take a day off from trying to jolly each other up today. We'll keep things upbeat, we'll keep things happy, but we have to deal in facts. Obviously, if I had spent the last 20 years telling you that the European Union was awful, I would be desperate to talk about absolutely anything else today. Probably Cornish pasties again, but you know, your lives matter to me, and by the middle of next month, your lives are going to be different. My life is going to be different. All our lives are going to be different. We'll come back. Some of the stuff we lose will be replaced. Some of the stuff we demolish will be rebuilt. Nobody's going to be able to pay their bills with a misunderstanding of what the word sovereignty means, but we will find new ways of muddling through together. And as is often the case, people who have the clearest picture of what is on the horizon will be the people doing the heaviest lifting in response to the problems that others have inflicted upon us all. And that, I'm afraid now, is simply a statement of fact. No blame except for the salesmen, the con men, and no triumphalism, because God forbid, how can you celebrate? Someone said to me yesterday, it would be like celebrating how bad Brexit will be, or celebrating no deal because you think it's going to teach a lesson to all the people who've been vile to you for the last half a decade. It would be like celebrating your flatmate getting COVID-19 because you had an argument a couple of weeks ago. He's your flatmate, you know, and it's a very infectious virus. You're going to celebrate them getting it. You're an absolute clown. But we are where we are. And I think I'd lead you back to there's a live briefing underway at the moment featuring the presidents of the European Council and Commission and the German Chancellor, Angela Merkel. So obviously we'll keep a very close eye on that. But I think that we called it correctly earlier this week when we offered up three options for Boris Johnson's trip to Brussels, and they were, they're very, very close to getting it over the line, and this is an opportunity for a photo opportunity. That was option one. Option two was, they really do think that Boris Johnson will be able to sprinkle some sort of stardust over proceedings and pull a rabbit out of a hat that nobody previously knew existed. That's an honest option. I to me, it sounds bonkers, but there are plenty of people who still have faith in Johnson, and there are even more people who are going to have to pretend that they do, because the alternative is admitting their own epic, I mean, industrial scale, unprecedented, unbelievably huge mistakes over the last few years. And then there is the third option, which is he just wants to be able to turn around and say, well, cogito ergo sum, folks, amo amassa mat, I did everything I possibly could, but here we are. When in reality, he has once again buckled to the lunatic fringe of his own party, who still don't understand what sovereignty means, but think that they have a better grasp of Australia's trading status than the former Prime Minister of Australia, who was on Question Time last night. And that, I think, hasn't changed. So there's still a slim chance that the optics or the theatre was designed to deliver an announcement with the backdrop of it being a triumph for both parties. But I would say the words, and I'm in the hilarious position at the moment of looking at Ursula von der Leyen's face without having subtitles on my screen, and so I am going to do something I have never done before and will hopefully never do again. And I'm going to say, looking at Ursula von der Leyen's face as she delivers this press conference, I do not believe that there is going to be good news coming out of this press conference. So the idea that it was all sewn up beforehand and you were just having the grandest of fromages putting the cherry on the icing on the cake this week seems to me to be disappearing, or at least slipping over the horizon. And that leaves you with the final choice, which is that it was lost before it started. There was no earthly way the European Union were going to allow us to retain benefits of membership while not having the responsibilities and requirements of membership. And I'll explain to you a little later why, actually, if they could have been a little bit more mature and honest about the level playing field issue, then the so-called deal that is on the table fits quite a lot of what Brexit has claimed that they wanted. That's the area of the greatest confusion for me. 12 minutes after 10 is the time, so that's it, really. You know, so there's three things. Those three options as to what was going to happen this week. It now looks very likely that option three is the winner. It was all over bar the shouting, but Johnson wants to be able to pretend that he's put in a shift for the first time in his life and actually sought to do some hard work when in fact the battle was already lost or the decision was already made. And then you come back to the other triumvirate, the other trio, the three-legged stool that I've been describing to you for God knows how long, which involves the equality of rules, i.e. everybody in the trading bloc has to abide by the same rules, and the rules are set by the members of the trading bloc, which until very recently we were, if not the, then certainly among the most senior and most influential members of the bloc that made the rules by which every member of the bloc must abide. If you're not going to obey the rules that are made by the bloc, then your trading relationship with the bloc is diminished and diluted. That's just obvious, or at least I used to think it was obvious. It clearly isn't obvious. So stage one of the stool is you've got to be in it to win it. You can't have the benefits. You can't do the frictionless free trade unless you abide by the rules set by the trading bloc. And of course, that's where gravity comes in, or at least size matters, if you prefer. The bigger you are, what is it, 500 million customers, you're going to have a lot more clout than a bloc that's a tenth of that size, i.e. us. We've now become a trading area that is smaller. The free trade area is smaller than the United Kingdom. That's an astonishing achievement, which I guess you're going to have to get up early to pretend that that's what you voted for. The second area that has not changed since 2016, or indeed 2010, the second area is the indivisibility of the four freedoms. You can't get rid of one without getting rid of all, and you can't have one without having all. So this determination to abolish our own freedom of movement, to turn us into a population that has freedom of movement between two countries, while every other European Union member retains freedom of movement between 27 countries, that's a big win for us, isn't it? Because two is much bigger than 27. Anyway, the indivisibility of the four freedoms, also denied or debated, ridiculously, really, looking back, you should never have let people into the public space who were so crushingly ignorant about the simplest of propositions. And then finally, the one that was perhaps a little greyer than the other two, but which has turned out to be just as easy to understand and just as predictable in the end game, which was the island of Ireland. And the simple fact that in order to observe the very spirit, the very essence of the Good Friday Agreement, you had to have the same regulatory framework on both sides of an invisible Irish border, or you had to either build a border through the middle of Ireland or put the border in the Irish Sea. Looking back on the phone-ins we've done together, I think that the furious stroke ignorant resistance of that simple point was among the most febrile, the most feverish. I don't really understand why. I think probably because they kept queuing up to claim it was easy to solve. Your Owen Pattersons and your Jacob Rees-Moggs and your Liam Foxes and all the rest of them. The technological solutions, or it's a red herring, or we'll fix it, or it won't happen. And do you remember when we spoke to someone on the programme whose bathroom, he'd built an extension since the peace process was completed, and his bathroom was in the north of Ireland and the rest of his house was in the south, and you suddenly just thought, hang on a minute, this ain't going to wash. So, I mean, you know, I'm conscious I want to put a few quid in the tin today. Someone pointed out on Twitter last night that Keith Get the Tin is up there with what's his name in the office? Mackenzie Crook's character. Gareth Get the Guitar. So with me in the role of David Brent and Keith in the role of Gareth, we've now managed to introduce Keith Get the Tin. Keith Get the Tin ready into the program's vocabulary. But I do want to put a few quid in the tin for obvious reasons. But I think I'd like you to tell me how it came to this, from any angle you want. This is the polar opposite of what we were told would happen by the people that wanted it. It's very close to what we were told would happen by the people who didn't want it. And I still don't fully grasp how it's happened. I'll say that again because it doesn't brook any contradiction. We're now looking at pretty much what all the people who didn't want Brexit said would happen, okay? And we're looking at the polar opposite of what all the people who did want Brexit said would happen. And yet the latter category remain convinced that they still want this thing that's turned out to be the polar opposite of the thing they said they wanted when they voted for it. So, I mean, we've all given it some thought. How do you explain it? I would do my coma gambit at this point if I hadn't already used it a bit. Imagine I'd fallen asleep at the beginning of 2016 and I woke up now and saw what the hell has been done to my country by some of the most dishonest and dense individuals ever to feature in public life. Quite incredible, the triumph of ignorance over observable evidence. But that's just me. Maybe you've got a more charitable or an even more cynical analysis. How has this happened? How have we ended up looking at all of the things that people who didn't want Brexit said would happen and none of the things that people who did want Brexit insisted were the easiest in human history? 03456060973 is the number that you need if you want to spare yourself my pontifications, because you could probably tell I could carry on for 3 hours uninterrupted today. I really could. I know I say that sometimes, but today I really blinking mean it. But I'm not sure any of us want that. So give me a call and tell me how you think this happened. I don't know that we want to necessarily use the word blame, but if that is a word that bubbles inevitably out of your consciousness, then that is a word I do want to hear. By way of balance, before we open up the phone lines, although there is, of course, nothing to prevent people like this from ringing in. In fact, I beg you to. O'Brien, you are talking the same old bile, just like the BBC. Shut up and get over it. This is all in capitals, although I have to point out it's correctly spelled, I think. Leaving the EU is the best thing for this country. And the reason why people like this are somewhat more reluctant to ring in than they used to be is because they know what happens next. You say that to me on the phone, I say, oh yes, why is that? Why is this the best thing for this country? And that's why everyone's so cross. Michael's in Barnes. Michael, what do you reckon?
Yes, well, it seems to me the situation is somewhat like people have blundered into wars in the past.
Yes.
There were a few who probably actually wanted them, but many others, you know, set out and didn't realise really what was going to happen at the end. And then they find themselves in a terrible situation, killing each other. And it's not really what they wanted. So I expect soon Dunkirk will be pulled out of the hat, and we'll be saying we've exited Europe and it's a great triumph for Britain.
Yes.
But the deal surely was always going to founder on the issue of sovereignty. Surely, you know, I'm not an expert at all, but when you sign a treaty, don't you give up a bit of sovereignty?
Well, I mean, this is again, I sense like you, Michael, I think this is so bleeding obvious, I can't believe it's still leading the national conversation, but if you trade under WTO rules, unless you get to set to them single-handedly, you give up some sovereignty.
Of course, yeah, absolutely.
Well, you say of course, and I say of course, and Kit's nodding like one of those dogs in the back of a car in the 1970s, but that half the country still doesn't understand this.
Yeah, but we do it in all sorts of other ways.
Yes.
In our own personal lives, we give up a bit of our sovereignty in order to have rules and the police and all that sort of thing.
To stay married.
Yes, it's all part of life, really. So it seems to me then that, therefore, the Brexiteers, the true ones, they never really want to give up anything to anybody. So how are they ever going to do a deal or negotiate it?
And yet, two thoughts occur to me. The first is that sovereignty didn't really rear its head verbally until quite late on in the game. It certainly didn't appear in the run-up to the referendum. That was all about money for the NHS and pesky foreigners and red tape and EU bureaucrats. Sovereignty wasn't ever really part of the conversation. It grew in importance as all the other promises fell apart until, with the possible exception of fish, this bogus notion of sovereignty was all that was left. And the other thing, and I'm going to choose my words very carefully because I think about this a lot, Michael, and I don't know quite what my conclusions are yet, but if we were to fight a righteous war And I know 2020 hindsight is a wonderful thing, but one thinks immediately of the Nazis. If we were to fight, you kind of need that queen and country, my country right or wrong mindset. I had this thought bizarrely for the first time during the Jubilee celebrations when I felt my heart swell with an almost incoherent pride, and I had a little taste of what that is for many, many people. We would never win a war unless you could persuade people that a flag was somehow more important than a fact, could we? We'd never win anything. We wouldn't even go.
No.
And that they have. That's why I loved your opening comment, because they've harnessed that sort of feeling. But unfortunately, there wasn't only an absence of enemy at the gates. They were our friends. They were our allies. They were our closest trading partners. And we've been persuaded. And that's why I go back to the text that I saw when I started on this program, talking about the EUSSR and the Fourth Reich. And I used to think it was funny. Well, no one's laughing now. Thank you, Michael. Bob's in Durham. Bob, what happened?
Good morning. I believe the word is, two words, English exceptionalism.
Yes. Go on.
We are so superior to the peoples of the rest of the world. And I was educated in the mid-60s. I went to secondary school. And history was just totally, we ruled the world. We were so brilliant. We were benevolent.
Okay. I'm in a very giving and generous mood today. And so I'm going to do, again, what I did with Michael. You're right, I think. And as I said to him, actually, I can see some benefits, oddly, to that bellicose mindset, that sort of unquestioning quasi-patriotism. But with you, if you think about how long we were members for, so park the Rule Britannia sense and the, you know, the idea that the world will be pink again one day, half the world will be pink again one day if we can only tweak this thing. If you go back to 2016, we'd been in it pretty much since the beginning. Certainly we'd been in the single market since Margaret Thatcher invented it. And that the idea that that should surely count for something, I don't want to give a break to people that have led us into this mess, but we're going to have to at some point start pulling together. You can see why that sensible people might have thought, well, they're not just going to treat us like any other third country, are they? Do you see what I mean?
I see what you mean, but I myself don't see that one little bit, because to me,
at 30 years of membership, all the money we'd paid in, they can't just treat us like Mongolia, we might have thought. I don't know. But anyway, it's on the list. And my thanks to Tom in Liverpool, who's tried to blame it on Remainers. I'll read that text out to you shortly. You just don't know anymore whether it's tongue-in-cheek. But of course, the people who have led the country into this catastrophe will be desperate, as ever, to blame it on anybody else other than themselves, including the people that described, in my case, in great detail, just what the catastrophe would look like. Keith, get the tin ready. I told you so. David's been in touch to say, you need a sound effect for when James puts money in the tin. I asked for this earlier in the week. I just want a cha-ching sound. Keith, get the tin. Gareth, get the guitar. Cha-ching! Another £10 for Hospice UK. There's nothing funny, of course, about the catastrophe that the country faces. And the tragedy of it is that it's entirely self-inflicted. However, I can see ways in which things could perhaps have gone better. I think that, obviously, the Lancaster House red lines were the end of the line for most of us. And then that's where, for me, it became pretty clear it was going to be no deal or no Brexit, which held true until Boris Johnson became Prime Minister. When Boris Johnson became Prime Minister, I know this sounds a bit facetious, but it isn't. I think it is just true. I felt that could perhaps be good news for people who understood the issues, because Boris Johnson has always struck me as someone who would lie to absolutely anyone, whether it's his own wife or his party leader. Well, it doesn't just strike me as that. He is. He's proven to be somebody who would lie to absolutely everyone, stroke anyone, if it would do him good in the short term. So I thought that he might lie to the ERG fringe or the you know, the really daft, thick as mince contingency of his own party. Or the xenophobes, of course, and they're usually the same person, but some of the xenophobes aren't as thick as mince. Most of the thick as mince members are xenophobes, but it's not a completely reflected cross-section. So that gave me a little bit of hope. I said to you at the time, I think we can put that in the fridge, the no deal or no Brexit conclusion, because Johnson will swear that the moon is made of cheese or that black is white, and he'll swear it to anyone. And that means that he might sign something and then claim publicly that he signed something completely different. I wonder, and by next week we may have some clarity on this, but I wonder whether he shot his bolt on that with the withdrawal agreement. I wonder whether actually the withdrawal agreement was the thing he signed despite telling everyone that he was signing something completely different. Ah, see, even after all these years, we still have fresh insights. So that when they then had to go back to the floor of the House of Commons to resile from or renege upon precisely the commitments that they had campaigned on, or the treaty they had literally won an election on, they had to, within a year, pass legislation that allowed them to break the law and betray the terms of that treaty. That's the best proof I can offer up of my statement that he'd lie about anything. And it for short-term gain, got him into Downing Street. It was a very effective lie, a very profitable lie, but still a lie. And that's why they needed to come back and pass legislation that would allow them to break the law. And that, maybe he shot his bolt by doing it on the withdrawal agreement, because they're not going to let him, or they won't, it won't wash when he tries to do it with an actual trade agreement. I don't know. Why do you think we've ended up here? Dan's in Horsham. Dan, sorry to keep you. What would you like to say?
Hi, James. Hello. Big advocate of your viewpoints.
They're not viewpoints, mate. They used to be viewpoints. Now they're facts.
Well, yeah, OK, I agree. And I've been sort of saying the same thing for the last 4 years.
Yeah.
But does this come back to one of the failings of the fact that the class system still exists? And people are inclined to confuse education and intelligence, and they are not the same thing.
You're damn right.
As the likes of Dominic Raab's lack of understanding over the Dover-Calais route, or even other politicians' view of not understanding the single market, have quite clearly displayed.
Yes. I mean, we're going to do next week, I think, and I hope, well, even if there is a flimsy deal, we'll still have to do this. The moments that really should have woken up the nation. And I guess the man who had become Secretary of State for Brexit, revealing, I mean, it's the lack of self-awareness as much as the lack of intelligence. Because if, this will sound odd, but if you were intelligent, you never would have said it out loud, would you? That I didn't realise how important the Dover-Calais crossing was to the UK's import-export markets. And I'm now Secretary of State for Brexit.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, without doubt, it's interesting to hear some of the callers on your show and on Majid's show over the last couple of years. Kieran the van driver, clearly a bright guy, knows what he's what he's talking about.
Living it.
Yeah, and Majid's had a guy come phone up a couple of times who's a city trader.
Right.
I think that's what he does. He's, you know, he sounds like an ordinary working class guy.
Yeah.
But he's so bright about understanding the economics of how this kind of thing has been working. You think, why is that man not sitting at a table at Cobra?
I mean, you know what I do at this point in proceedings. I wheel out the old doff cap tug forelock phrase, but I'm afraid that is what you're describing, isn't it? If somebody is wearing a top hat or a monocle, metaphorically speaking, or not in Jacob Rees-Mogg's case probably, and sounds like they've swallowed a pound of plums and got four of them stuck in their gobs still, there is a tendency among much of the country to think that they must be clever.
Absolutely. Can I mention an unseen casualty that's just come to my attention with the mention of the word Dunkirk earlier on, because that always gets brought in. In the last 3 or 4 years, I've split my time between being a Western Front battlefield guide as well as working security in London. And one of the things that's just come to light this week is the plight of some of the people employed by the Commonwealth War Graves Commission,
right,
who have literally been given 3 weeks to look at relocating back to the UK from across Europe and Cyprus. I understand the PCS Union are looking into it, and there's gone to a consultation with Ben Wallace. But the irony is, these people look after those that are lauded by Brexiteers about, you know, take Barnier, take us to a Commonwealth War Grave Cemetery and show them the sacrifice.
Yeah, I know.
And yet, that organisation now is subject to a major restructuring as a result of the fact that, you know, we seem to be leaving the EU and it has a direct effect on their operations.
I did not know that. Can you just stay on the line and give Ava a little bit more information about that, Dan? Would you mind?
No, not at all. I mean, I'm still researching it myself because I only found out about it yesterday.
Okay. Well, I mean, that is going to be the flavour of 2021 and hopefully not too far beyond. But that's just interesting to me. And of course, we're all going to have to walk the tightrope between complete and utter vindication and triumphalism, because there is nothing to celebrate by being proved right about all this. Literally nothing. You know, because all of the problems and pain on the horizon, it hurts and hits all of us. And the only thing I'd say, which I've said to you all along, is that those with the most will be hit the least. So your Rees-Moggs and your Raabs, they're going to be a hell of a lot more insulated from this than the Toyota workers in Sunderland who were persuaded to vote for their own, I'd still like to say, potential rather than imminent, so potential oblivion. This is Tom in Liverpool. If the hardcore Remainers had accepted the result of the referendum and entered into a conversation with more than just continuously shouting that leavers are stupid and or racist, then we would not be in the position we are today, says Tom, who almost certainly voted to leave, because no Remainers continuously shouted that leavers are stupid and or racist. I know that because I'm often accused of it. And anyone who listens to this programme with even 1% of honesty will know that it's complete nonsense. The fact that Dominic Raab was allowed to say it on this radio station without being challenged is, in fact, a very useful part of the explanation of how this astonishing catastrophe and con has been visited upon an entire country. The media bears enormous responsibility. But Tom goes on, the hardcore liberal, holier-than-thou Remainers have had a significant effect in shaping the hard Brexit narrative. Keith, get the tin ready. Because I told you this was going to happen, and you probably thought I was joking, and do you know what? 10% of me probably was. 10% of me when I said they'll try and blame it, because it happened with Corbyn, you see? Those of us who explained repeatedly why Jeremy Corbyn was catastrophic for the Labour Party and completely unelectable ended up being blamed for the fact that Jeremy Corbyn was catastrophic for the Labour Party and completely unelectable. It's a heavy cross to bear, but exactly the same thing as Thomas just unintentionally demonstrated will happen with Liverpool. The people what did it will try to blame the people that begged them not to do it for the mess that they've created. I told you so. Mark's in Beckenham. Mark, what's going on?
Yeah, hi there.
Hello.
Coming at this from a slightly strange angle, but I used to go and watch England abroad football in the 80s and 90s, and the guys that did that, and I'm not saying everybody felt the same way, but the sort of the shock troop of the right,
yes,
the anti everything brigade, who came from a sort of football hooliganism background, and then entered the sort of political arena. And when they were hooligans, their mantra was they never back down.
Yes.
Never back down. And they've sort of, once sort of hooliganism sort of stopped and they just sort of had something else to sort of focus on, they still kept that mantra. So, you know, as far as they're concerned, the Germans were losers, the Italians were losers, the French were losers. You know, they lost the war and they'd never got over it. And then you see the same thing, feeling the same way from the sort of Eton Brigade as well.
Yes.
But they also feel that they've got this right.
Well, some of them do, some of them don't. But I know you know that. I'm just
But you conflate.
Because Rory Stewart went to Eton, remember? So I don't know why I'm defending generalisations about Eton College, but we are where we are.
But you conflate the two sides of a
coin. They're identical, but this is back to deference, isn't it? Because I've often said if he was wearing a chalk striped suit instead of a Stone Island denim jacket, he'd probably be on Question Time every week.
Exactly.
Talking about whoever you want to slot into that category. If you went to Harrow and you come out with the same stuff that the EDL came out with, you will be on Question Time every week.
Yeah, I mean, it's tragic, really. I mean, and you've got a lot of people who... these are simple solutions to complex problems, and that's really where the whole of the Brexit came in. It was a very simple solution to something that nobody really wanted to...
Well, it wasn't even a problem. I mean, it was an imperfection that people treated like a catastrophe. And I am going to allow myself, because I'm going to need the royalties if I carry on chucking these £10 notes into the tin. I am going to allow myself to tell you that in my new book, I do actually describe, I use the word, Mark, footballification, to describe what you've... there, because it's the only thing I can think of. I don't care what's in the tin. I only care about the colour of the tin. So if the tin is red, white and blue, I don't care if it contains a whopping great cow pat. That's what I wanted all along. There's a tin over there which has got a European Union flag on it. It's got a gold bullion in it. We don't want any of that. 11 o'clock is the time. I used Harrow as an example there, partly to draw attention away from the Eton generalisation, but also because Eton has actually closed. I don't know if you encountered any complaints about teachers seeking to protect themselves from possible infection in the run-up to Christmas by some state schools closing a little early. People who got upset about that are going to be absolutely furious to hear that every boy at Eton College is being sent home early this weekend. Of course, I'm just listening to that Ursula von der Leyen speech there, the little clip in the news, and again feeling the fear that it's going to be no deal after all grow. Because it sounds to me like she's already... I mean, she won't have to worry about this much anymore, but in the short term, she has to worry about the lies that Boris Johnson is still telling. So that explanation of what would happen every time they decide to raise their level of ambition, in other words, to raise food protection standards or health and safety regulations or workplace rights. Every time they raise it, they raise that bar, we would have to follow if we wanted to retain whatever deal we sign. As she's just explained, if they didn't want to follow that, then we could redraw those arrangements and those agreements. It's so blindingly obvious that I couldn't work out why she was saying it, and I suddenly realised Johnson's been lying about that. If Boris Johnson is, as he claims, intending to pursue higher standards than the European Union, how can he in the same breath express fears that the European Union would punish us for not following their standards if we're going to go higher? You do not get punished in the high jump for clearing the bar. However, you do get penalised if you dive under it and claim that you've broken the world record, which one imagines would be the Boris Johnson tactic were he ever to have gone into the world of athletics. Instead, he went into the world of politics, as did an Australian chap called Malcolm Turnbull, who, like Boris Johnson, ended up Prime Minister of his country, in this case, the country of Australia. So, although I would not dream of suggesting for a minute that a former Prime Minister of Australia may have a better grasp of Australia's trading status than, for example, Nadine Dorries or Jacob Rees-Mogg, I do think it's worth listening to a former Prime Minister of Australia, as the liars responsible for Brexit, try to inflate the nonsense that we will be enjoying an Australia-style arrangement with the European Union. In the spirit of that time, I had to treat Andrea Leadsom as an equal and opposite authority on the WTO to Pascal Lamy, who used to run the WTO, here with the caveat that he clearly doesn't know as much about Australia as Priti Patel does. Here is the former Prime Minister of Australia.
Well, it'll be pretty disappointing. I think you'll find out where we have obviously a deal with the EU on WTO terms, and there are really some very large barriers to Australian trade with Europe, which we're seeking to address as we negotiate a free trade agreement with Europe. But Australians would not regard our trade relationship with Europe as being a satisfactory one. I mean, we do have, it's our third biggest trading partner, I guess, collectively, because it's such a big economy. But there are very big barriers to Australian exports of agricultural products in particular. You know, there's a lot of friction in the system in terms of services. So, you know, there's a lot to aim for. And, you know, when I was Prime Minister, we started formal negotiations of a European-Australia free trade agreement, but that will take some time. So, you know, be careful what you wish for. I mean, Australia's relationship with the EU is not one from a trade point of view that Britain, I think, would want, frankly.
No, I stress again, that's only Scott Turnbull, former Prime Minister of Australia, talking about Australia's trading arrangements as he understands them. Take it with a pinch of salt until you find out what J-Dog has to say. J-Dog marching ever onwards from the triumphs of his epic understanding of the Good Friday Agreement. David's in Coventry. David, how did this happen?
Well, I'm not sure how the sovereignty ended up on the shopping list. Once it was there, I think no deal's inevitable, because any compromise with the negotiations is a you know, letting go of our sovereign position. So that I think is where the Brexit people are just now.
They can never really tell you what it means, can they? Because NATO membership has obligations that,
yes, of course,
that involve a dilution of sovereignty. I know you know this, and most people listening know this, but there'll be still some people that don't understand it. I think I know why it ended up front and centre.
Yeah, well, as I say, I think that's the... Things like the withdrawal agreement, when that got through on the nod, and we thought, well, why didn't Parliament bother to debate it?
Yes.
Well, obviously...
Well, Ian Duncan Smith said they didn't need to. Ian Duncan Smith said they didn't need to debate it because they all understood it so perfectly. And then within a few months, he was touring the studios explaining why they needed to pass legislation that allowed them to break the thing he understood so perfectly it didn't need to be debated or studied at the time.
But
put that on the list, will you?
It didn't matter what it said, did it?
No, put that on the list for next week. The moments of that distill Brexit to its purest essence. That was Duncan Smith saying we don't need to study this treaty because we're all so clever, and then a few months later say, oh my God, we've got to get out of this treaty. It's awful. David raises, it's a great point you raise. To answer your question, it's pretty obvious. When I explained why we would end up, we get the tin ready, Keith. When I explained why we would end up with just fish and passports, that was before the word sovereignty had even entered into the debate. So once all of the substantive pledges, promises, claims had fallen apart, you had to have something abstract left for people to shout and to you know, write on their little placards in the question time audience. You couldn't point at anything real. You couldn't say 350 million quid for the NHS. You couldn't say better trading arrangements. You couldn't say improvements to the economy. You couldn't say this. You couldn't say that. You couldn't actually point at anything substantive or real or concrete. So you had to point at an idea or a concept or a slogan. And that's why sovereignty rose rapidly up the totem pole of Brexit nonsense, just as all of their claims fell apart like various cheap suits. Ken's in Bromley. Ken, what happened?
Hi. Well, the reason why Europe is not budging is because no other European country has ever given its voters the option to leave the organisation. And if they compromise with us this time, unfortunately, other countries would seek to get the same sort of deal we get, and the EU would collapse.
That doesn't make sense, Ken.
It does.
No, it really doesn't.
It does. That's why.
Right.
They can't afford.
And did you not realise this before you voted to leave?
Well, I mean,
because that's a pretty big omission on your part, isn't it? It's a very honest admission of you today. Because I mean, if you're right and you're not, but you didn't realise it and you didn't, then I mean, that's a lot of egg on your face.
Yeah, but you see, you have a go at people who are Brexiteers.
No, I'm being really nice to you, mate. I'm saying I salute your honesty. Here's a massive problem that you completely failed to see, and I'm giving you a get-out clause by explaining that you're wrong.
Now say something
rude. Now say something rude about me.
See if you recognise this quote. People who voted for Brexit were the types who would welcome child food poverty. Do you recognise that quote?
Some people who voted for Brexit would be the types who voted for child food poverty, Ken.
No, people who voted. That's exactly what you said.
Well, it doesn't have to be all, Ken. Okay, so talk to me about Marcus Rashford.
That is a slanderous, outrageous comment. You are a snake in the grass. You should never, ever be allowed to say that. And I'm surprised nobody else has had the guts to phone you up to hold you to task.
Ken, because
Brexiteers for that?
No, Ken. Would you tell me?
Will you apologise?
Ken, you can't just keep saying I'm not going to apologise to you, Ken, because Marcus Rashford proved my point perfectly. And I think if I said that, I said it before Brexit. Marcus Rashford proved that Brexiters have got absolute cover. One of the Brexit supporting MPs, mate, came out and said that they can't give children, hungry children, free school meals because they take the vouchers to crack dens and brothels.
And I also voted for Rashford.
You can't vote for Rashford, you silly man, honestly. No, you can't vote for Marcus Rashford. That's a petition. Anyway, Ken, I'm very sorry that you understand so little. Let's go back.
Because
you've already said that, Ken. You've already said that, Ken. So why do you think it's...
would welcome child poverty.
Yes, and they do.
And another thing, do you ever speak to Majid Nawaz?
Not really, no.
Okay. When he was covering for you on holiday 2 months ago,
yes, Ken.
So many listeners said how refreshing it was that between 10 and 1, there was no longer incessant prejudice criticism of the government.
Yes, I'm sure so people like you, Ken, I'm not going to criticise a colleague, but here you are talking twaddle unchallenged. So enjoy it. So much balance. All right, let's have a bit more balance, Ken. Who just called who a snake in the grass?
You are a snake in the grass for saying that.
Just want to clarify that.
Who would welcome child food poverty? Well, and you should apologise to all listeners.
Oh, Ken, could you name a Remainer that was anti-Marcus Rashford for me before you go?
I'm not interested.
I know you're not interested. That's what you mean by guts. Could you name a Remainer that was anti-Marcus Rashford for me?
I quoted exactly what you said, and third time running, you're a snake in the grass. For saying that,
could you name a prominent Remainer that was anti-Marcus Rashford? Before you go, Ken.
I'm not interested. I'm only interested.
Could you please try, Ken? Could you just name one Remainer who was anti-Marcus Rashford?
And next time you speak to Majid Nawaz, you find out just how he got so many listeners who were saying for once between 10 and 1 there was no longer prejudiced criticism of the government.
Ken, mate. You've insulted me, you've talked twaddle, And you've repeated yourself while refusing to answer any of my questions. One more.
Recognise exactly what I say.
Yes, Ken.
You should never say that Brexiteers would welcome child food policy.
I love this,
that
mate.
That is slanderous thing to say.
It's not, though, is it? Because they do.
It is a slanderous thing to say, and you should apologise to everybody right now.
Ken, here's the point of Brexit, right? And I appreciate you're not ready to grasp this yet.
You're diverting away from your statement.
No, I'm diverting you back to the programme you've rung into.
I can see you've probably got embarrassment written all over you. You should never have said that.
Well, that's why I've cut you off and faded you out while you were still talking, Ken, because, you know, that is a mark of exactly how I... Oh, Ken, please don't hang up. Can we ring him back? That's just not fair. Oh, can we just double check that he... So you look at 4 years of Brexit conversations. You're sitting there contemplating the carnage, the chaos and the catastrophe that you've inflicted upon our country, upon your own country. You're still complaining about the people who've predicted it and explained it at every single turn. And then having insulted them, you hang up while claiming that you're not being listened to or heeded. Can we just double check that he did hang up then and not actually get cut off accidentally or something like that? Nothing at all? All right, Ken, mate, this is a serious message for you and everybody like you. You have to let it go. You have to let it go, all right? You fell into a trap. You were led there by incredibly well-funded and well-resourced people. You were led there by incredibly sophisticated campaigns. You have voted to make yourself and your children and your grandchildren poorer. You voted for millions of British people to have their lifestyles diminished and many even to lose their livelihoods. But I know that you didn't do it on purpose. I know that you didn't know what you were doing. And I know that you will at some point have to let it go, okay? If you've honestly sat at home thinking, I'm going to ring James O'Brien and I'm going to get one over on him by reading out something he said about food poverty, God knows how many years ago, you didn't clock that I'd been proved completely right by precisely the opposition to Marcus Rashford's campaign to tackle food poverty. You have to see what they've done to you. They've turned you into somebody who humiliates himself on national radio and then has to run away. I haven't turned you into that. I'll take whatever abuse, you can call me a snake in the grass until you're blue in the face, but I didn't turn you into this person. And you weren't this person before this mess started. You've been turned into this person by two things: lies that you believed and a completely understandable, stubborn refusal to accept that you were lied to. There's a book available at the moment called How Not to Be Wrong, The Art of Changing Your Mind. It's by a snake in the grass, but nonetheless, I promise you that if you read it, you will reach Christmas feeling much happier and much more at peace about what has been done to you. Because it's an action that has been visited upon you. It's a corruption that you have been exposed to. It's not part of who you are. And you have to let it go. And that obviously is a message intended not just for Ken. Man alive, it's a funny old victory, isn't it, when it leaves you even angrier than you were before the game started. But that is what we are going to have to map together. And I stress again, that the people who deserve our derision and our contempt are the people that sold this project, not the people that bought it. And I understand why that upsets some of you so much, and that your anger still gets directed at the people who did do this to us. But I think it's important to stress repeatedly, contempt for the con men, compassion for the conned. 22 minutes after 11. And just to clarify, You can say whatever you want on this program, but I do reserve the right to ask you questions in return. And I appreciate that that can be a little bit troubling for some people still. Jay's in Haringey. Jay, what's going on? What happened?
No, I just wanted to say that I think that if you think back to the referendum campaign, which seemed to be emotion versus rationality, I think we're sort of at the same place now, and that it's an ideology. The sovereignty is an ideology. And I think the big implication of that is that if we get no deal now, we're not going to get a deal for the life of this parliament, of this government, because they are ideologically opposed to it. So unless that changes, there will be no deal with the EU until we have a new government that kind of doesn't believe in the same sort of concept of sovereignty.
But it can't go on indefinitely, can it? Because, I mean, the simple truth is that observing WTO terms involves a surrender of sovereignty if we have to continue using this silly language, or being in NATO involves a surrender of sovereignty if we have to carry on using this language. So I wish we knew. I wish people had said what laws when I kept asking that question over the years, because it would really help if they could say the reason why we can't sign this deal is because we want to be free to do X, Y, and Z. But given that the only suggestions that ever fit into that space involve declining our food standards or diminishing protections and regulations, they can't, I think this is my theory, they can't come out and say we can't sign up to the level playing field because we want to go lower than EU regulations currently go. And yet, if that's not the reason why they can't sign up to the level playing field, I don't know what is.
Yeah.
What do they want to do that they can't do now?
That is an extremely good question.
I've been asking it for 4.5 years, but then, you know, that's the problem with being a snake in the grass. Not everyone can hear you. Jay, thank you. Jonty's in St John's Wood. Jonty, what's going on?
Hi, James. Don't worry, I'm not going to call you any names.
You're more than welcome to. No, Keith,
yeah, well,
you can't, mate. It's a privilege only for callers, not for colleagues. Carry on, Jonty.
I'm a Remainer, which means I voted Remain, but once the democratic vote came in, I felt like I was exercising my British conscience by saying that we should really wholeheartedly unite behind Brexit, not because I agree with it, but because it was democratically elected.
Yes, I wasn't of that ilk, obviously, but I understood it. It was, drop names, but Susanna Reid explained that to me best, and I completely see the sense in it. I'm not sure I still do.
Well, I'd like to point out, although this wasn't my main point, I'd like to point out that I think those Remainers, and by the way, I persuaded quite a few other people to vote Remain as well. I was quite a strong Remainer.
Yes.
Those Remainers that didn't unite, I think they should look at themselves because they contributed to the disunity that has made this whole thing go on a lot longer. And I think it is a British value to rally round a united democratic vote.
But it was... No, I am going to pick up on that because the abolition of freedom of movement is you overlooking it. There was no earthly way anything could have gone differently if they remained married to the abolition of freedom of movement. And the minute they started boasting about it was the minute that where we are now, whatever happens in the next few days, became absolutely inevitable. So
what's your point got to do with my point? I don't understand.
But Remainers could not have contributed to a more civilized discourse or conversation that might have led to a softer Brexit, unless the abolition of freedom of movement was taken off the table. And if that was taken off the table, then EFTA or EEA or a Norway or a Switzerland style arrangement would have become possible. But all they could sell, and Theresa May did this, to be fair, not the current lot, all they could actually sell to the Brexit rump was, look what we've done, we've abolished freedom of movement. And if you took that away, then there'd have been absolutely nothing left. So I feel that quite strongly, actually.
No, that's a good point. The main point I wanted to make was I do strongly think there will be a deal. And I think what's going on right now...
I'll have a bit of what you're having this morning.
Yeah, well, here's my rationale. I wouldn't bet on it.
No, nor do I.
This is a guesstimate. But here's what I think is going on. And I'm really simplifying. I think this is an Anglo-French issue, ultimately, mainly. And I think Macron actually apparently gets on well with Boris Johnson, but Macron is talking to the to those voters that may potentially vote for the National Front. And I think Boris Johnson is talking to his Brexiteers. So that's the compass, that's the chessboard. And at the moment, both politicians are putting as much into the political bank as possible of those respective electorates through the rhetoric. And I think there is going to be fairly choreographed meeting of minds where both sides are able to sell the same deal with a different style, saying they won at the last moment. I think the issue of sovereignty, because it's so abstract, and you're quite right, it's highly nuanced. So this black and white sovereignty issue is nonsense, as you point out, with WTO, et cetera, NATO. I think because it's so abstract, that's the perfect subject for a politician to be able to lie, fudge, and be ambiguous on. And I think that it's all going to be sort of fudged and in the wording, and Macron and Johnson will both be able to sell it to their respective electorates and we'll have a deal at the last moment.
I mean, I hope you're right, even though it would involve saying, yes, they are both pandering to the far right. But sometimes, I mean, bedfellows can be very, very strange, can't they? And
true.
I don't know where the clock stops ticking, though, on this. But I do, obviously, I hope you're right, because any deal at all has got to be considerably better than no deal. 11:29 is the time. Ashlyn Rainham will be up next. After the news, actually, we'll talk to Matthew Sweet, who is, among many other things, he's a brilliant broadcaster and writer, but he's also something of a historian of the screen and a student of Barbara Windsor's life and career, which I'm at pains today to demonstrate to you, is so much more than the Carry On films and EastEnders. Massive and seminal though those two contributions to the showbiz pageant were, she was, I mean, I didn't realise just how fascinating her career and life had been until there was a brilliant sort of dramatisation of her life. I'll dig out the reference for you during the news and make sure you get a proper heads up about it. But after the latest headlines, we'll have a chat with Matthew, and then I'll give you a heads up on that beautiful film that I watched relatively recently, and the role that her father, or almost like the memory of her father, played in her life. It was a beautiful piece of drama, actually. So there's two reasons to stay tuned. Three, if you include me. I never know at 10 o'clock, obviously, every day I never know quite what direction the show is going to go in, but the appetite for having a conversation about the single most important event that this country has witnessed since the Second World War seems to be unabated. So until you tire of it, I will continue to ask why you, or how you think we came to this, how we came to this position. I would add in, but I think it's a little early, I would add in why the people who still think they've won are still so angry. But I don't yet have the way to do that in a way that won't sound provocative or like I'm deliberately trying to add to their burdens. But it's a useful bit of context to the broader picture, isn't it? Why are the winners who've spent 4.5 years telling us you lost, get over it, and feasting upon our liberal tears, or whatever the current meme may be, why are they still so furious? That is just weird, right? But hey-ho, not today. Today I want the roadmap, the descriptions of how we ended up where so many of us feared, stroke knew, stroke predicted we would end up. The reason why very right-wing people have such a problem with so-called lovies or drama or theatre is precisely because it is one of the only ways in which we are introduced to what it would be like to be somebody else. You know, you'd say that drama or fiction is the mother of empathy. And empathy, of course, is the sworn enemy of fascism, because you will not feel sorry for people risking their lives in flimsy dinghies in the English Channel unless you are somehow capable of imagining yourself in the same situation. So I think you probably know that already, but it's always worth pointing out when so much effort is put into persuading you that the people in the dinghies, or the people in the case of today's conversation in other European Union countries, are somehow fundamentally different and or inferior to the rest of us. 11:43 is the time, and Mark's in East Ham. Mark, how did this happen, do you think?
I think the European Union never sold itself to Great Britain.
Was it their job to do so, do you think?
Well,
it's a good point. It's a great point.
Wait a minute. Yeah, when you leave, you go home on a train or do you drive?
Here, I get the train and bus.
Right, ask everybody on the tube.
Well, I'm not going
to
do that.
To name
mate.
5 members of the European Parliament.
These days.
5 MPs.
Yeah, well, there aren't any now, are there? We've already gone.
No, but in the last 40 years, how has Europe told the United Kingdom what a great thing it is? I get a magazine once a month from my London borough telling me what they're doing. But if, like, when they give 9 billion euros to Poland, what do they spend it on?
I don't know.
What does a man on the street know about the European Union except von der Leyen and Barnier?
And going back all fish and quotas and stuff like that. I think you're right, actually. Let me interrupt.
Okay. When all this kicked off, I tried to read the common fish, the CPF, the common fisheries policy.
Yes.
I tried to read it.
Okay.
Well, you get down to line 5 and I just couldn't make sense of it. I just think the people in... I mean, how tall are you? I'm 6'3". I don't say 2.1 metres. We went decimal in 1970.
Yeah.
The European Union could have done a bit more. I'm not slating them. I'm
no,
just
I know
saying,
you're not. I mean,
if it's so good, if it's such a great thing to be in, why on earth didn't we see a bit more of the...
Well, I think I know if I can have a crack at answering you. Can I? Well, imagine if they had... I think Mark, you make a brilliant point. I'm not sure that we're pointing at the right culprit, though, because imagine if the European Union spent a few million quid on a letter or a document that was going to go through every letterbox in this country, particularly in the areas where European Union investment has been highest, like Cornwall and some of the other very poverty-stricken parts of our islands. Imagine if they'd spent a few million quid on a leaflet that had gone through every letterbox in the country.
Yeah, imagine.
But wait, and now you turned your radio on the next morning, or you opened the Sun or the Daily Mail or the Daily Telegraph, how would they have reported, not the contents of the document, mate, but the cost of the publication? How would they have reported it?
Yeah, but you're asking the wrong bloke, because I don't read the papers. I'm selective with the news that I choose to read.
Okay, well then I'll tell you how they'd have. They would have talked about wasting our money on vanity exercises.
I know, but look, listen. There's millions of people to frame an opinion. A newspaper doesn't frame my opinion.
I'm not suggesting for a moment that it does. I'm just explaining to you perhaps one reason why the European Union didn't go down the path that you describe. But you also have three or more decades of denigration. And you're absolutely right. You speak to people in other European countries, and they, I mean, the only MEPs most of us could have named at some point were the ones who'd been elected to get us out of the European Union, which is almost hilarious, isn't it?
Every Wednesday, we have Prime Minister's Question Times, Boris and Keir, blah, blah, blah. Now, that goes out on the telly and on the radio station, so people all over Europe, if they want to, can listen to that.
Yes.
I just had a great big thing in Europe yesterday about Turkey, about Cyprus,
yes,
about going green. Why didn't we see that on the telly? Why didn't we hear it on the radio?
Well,
you know, why are we so distant from something that is supposed to be so fantastic?
No one
knows nothing about it. I'm telling you.
I know, mate. I just need to pause you slightly, because there's a slightly aggressive tone in this conversation, and I think we're both on exactly the same.
I'm not aggressive.
No.
But look, you said why we are where we are now is because people voted... And
without knowing enough to cast an informed
vote. Because the European Union never said enough, in my opinion.
Okay, well, that's where I disagree with you, because but only insofar as who the messenger is. The message is the reason why we are where we are. No one ever defended it. And even when the referendum started, Mark, it was like a retro active response to what the other side said. Nobody went out and said, this is why being in the European Union is good. All they ever did was say, this is why leaving the European Union would be bad. And of course, what Project Fear then did was allow all of the people who perhaps weren't in great possession of fact or evidence, they could just turn around to the other lot whose predictions or forecasts have mostly come true and just poo-poo them. They could just say, Project Fear, and now it's all coming true. It's Project Here.
I know people can say Project Fear.
Yes.
I know people can poo-poo it. But if I would have seen a lot more of what the European does, the European Union does, where the money goes, what the good things that come out of it, where all the good things happen, who benefits from it, I reckon a lot more people would have voted
in a different way. I do too.
But they're a silent entity.
All right, one more thing, just by way of an illustration of my point. I think of foreign aid, and there is some money spent on foreign aid that's a joke, right? Some of it goes into the pockets of corrupt local officials. Some of it is spent on schemes that are daft. Those, and I know you don't read the paper, so you're going to have to trust me on this. A certain type of colonist...
I can't trust you. You're a Catholic. You went to private school.
I have a snake in the grass as well, Mark. Don't forget that.
Yeah, well done, Ken.
But here's the point. Foreign aid also is largely for the good, but the only elements of it that ever get reported are the negative elements, and that's what's happened with the European Union over 30 years. But you possibly won't know that.
Yeah, but look, again.
Yeah.
Why don't you see on the telly or in the papers the good foreign aid does?
Well, I know I can answer this.
All the good people doing good things.
Yes, exactly.
Never get a hearing. It's just people that say, well, that's bad. So yes. Then everybody thinks it's bad.
Well, yes, we are in complete harmony.
I tell you, I reckon the EU is going to be kicking himself up the arse for really not putting himself a bit more about in
Great
Britain.
Well, it wasn't their job. This is where we will agree to disagree. It wasn't their job to do it. And they would have been treated. I thought we were getting close to a concord there. That any attempts to portray the positives would have been treated like any attempts to portray the negatives. And the short answer to your question of why we only focus on negatives and we only report the bad stuff is, very simply, it's a hell of a lot easier to sell tickets for the ghost machine, the ghost train even, than it is for the speak your weight machine. My apologies, I went a little late to the last break. I was enjoying that conversation so much. It sounded to you like we were having a ding-dong, right? And you know, a couple of little below-the-belt jabs headed in my direction, but I think we were agreeing with each other on the disaster that we now face and disagreeing perhaps on where the responsibility lay, because you know and I know that, well, where would you have gone? A few people have been in touch to say that some of the MEPs in the Southwest did publish documents showing what they had done, what the European Parliament or the European Union had done. And I know when I'm overseas, I notice it more. I don't know if it's here. So, for example, if you're going up the new roads in Greece, you'll often see European Union signage showing that they had something to do with the funding. You see it at sites of particular heritage interest, historical interest. I've seen some in the UK, but I don't know. So I'm just wondering, in response to the last caller, I'm just wondering whether actually any indications are put up or published on projects that we could trace back to European Union sponsorship. And I know the response is, well, we can pay for our own now that we're not making all the contributions, but I'm afraid that takes us back to the car boot sale, doesn't it? And we perhaps, if next week we do the greatest hits of Brexiters whose boneheaded comments best distilled the madness that's engulfed us all, we might go back over my own favourite analogies, because the car boot sale is one of the best. And the car boot sale analogy now makes the most perfect sense. Perhaps, I think it did all along, actually. I'm not going to indulge in any false modesty. So the way it works, you can take it alongside the gym membership analogy. So we're not paying to be members of the gym anymore, but we fully expect to be able to continue to use the jacuzzi and the weights room and the tennis courts and the swimming pool. And I'm obviously a member of a very smart gym. Or I'm not, but I just expect to continue to be able to use the facility. So that works quite well. That is roughly where we are today, with the gym saying, I'm really sorry, I know you've been a member for 30 years, but if you resign your membership, you are just a non-member. There's no special category for ex-members. And you could say, but I've paid £500 a month to be a member of this gym for 30 years. That's a hell of a lot of money you've had off me. And you'll say, yes, but it was very good value for money. And now you're not paying it, so you don't get any value for, you get no value for no money. So take the gym membership. This is good, actually. Take the gym membership and then take the car boot sale. The car boot sale, for me, was a moment of almost unparalleled clarity, because the financial argument, like all other pro-Brexit arguments, made sense until you started asking questions. It made sense until you started tugging at the thread. So we pay £350 million a week. Not actually true, but let's say that it was. For the sake of argument, let's just leave that number front and centre. We pay 350 million quid. We could give it to the NHS, plays to our emotions in an incredibly powerful way. But ignore all of that. Focus solely on the money, all right? There's 350 million quid. We currently pay that to be a member of the European Union. Therefore, if we stop paying it, we'll be 350 million quid a week better off. Full stop, end of story. Doff cap, tug forelock, vote Brexit, right? And then, and I don't think I came up with this myself, I think someone rang it in or texted it in. Then the analogy of the car boot sale comes along, right? And obviously the numbers are rather smaller, unless you've got an epic stall at a very big market. So you pay 50 quid every week for your pitch at the car boot sale, right? 50 quid every week for your pitch at the car boot sale. If you stop doing the car boot, you'll be 50 quid a week better off. Full stop, doff cap, tug forelock, vote Brexit. You see? The problem is, of course, that you turn a profit of 200 quid every week on your initial 50 quid investment in the pitch at the car boot sale. And that, for me, of all the analogies and all the metaphors and all the similes and all the clever analyses that we've indulged in together over the last 4.5 years, that for me is the main one. You pay 50 quid a week for your pitch at the car boot sale. You stop paying 50 quid a week for your pitch at the car boot sale, you will be 50 quid a week better off. And then a snake in the grass comes along and starts hissing about the fact that actually you make a 200 quid profit every week at that car boot sale. Profit even after you've paid the 50 quid. So actually, although you can set up the facts in a way that might make it look as if you're going to be £50 a week better off, you're going to be £200 a week worse off. I mean, it's the very definition of better late than never. But Mark in East Ham making the point that the European Union should have done more to tell us about the benefits of membership. I didn't establish whether he was speaking with a sort of buyer's remorse, having voted for Brexit and now realising what a mistake it was, or whether he was frustrated at the time of the referendum that so many people knew so little about so much. And I was guilty of that myself. There's no holier than thou on that front, because like you, I really can only draw upon English language media, and I've only really started reading Irish media since the referendum result came in, just for a bit of a reality check. And also, you know, I reach for the cheaper prints, the easier reads first in the morning. I don't reach for the Financial Times and the Guardian. I reach for the Mail and then the Times. So that I can absorb what's going on, find out what the enemy's thinking. The news pages of those papers are a hell of a lot more sanitary than the comment pages, or certainly the columns. But, until I started reading the Irish Times and following RTE, I had no idea how we looked from overseas. But anyway, the definition of better late than never is now dropping into my inbox with people like Sarah Jane and Terry showing me signage demonstrating European Union funding in France in the first case. And it's a local viaduct, and in Porthcawl in the second place. But that development has recently gone pear-shaped. Nothing to do with the EU investment, says Terry. And a few other people as well. Thomas, I think this one's in Ireland again. The sign at the bottom, this project has received financial assistance from the European Regional Development Fund. I think Mark was right. I don't remember seeing anything like that. I think I once saw one on a hoarding in Cornwall. But I could be imagining it. And yet you're sending me photographs from all over the European Union of projects where the signage states that this was funded in part by the European Union. To go back to the car boot very, very briefly, because, of course, you could respond by saying, well, if we weren't sending the money to Europe, they're sending some of it back. This is a point made up in an unsigned text. If I made 50 quid loss every week at the car boot sale on top of the 50 quid parking fee, that's the reality. OK, mate. To stay with the analogy in the first instance, you can't really run a loss at a car boot sale, okay? On top of what you've paid for the pitch. If you pay for the pitch and sell nothing, you come out one pitch fee down. So the point you miss, and I'm afraid, I don't want to sound rude, but it's highly unlikely that you have a better grasp of this than every single economic forecast that's been undertaken by pretty much every single respected institution and outlet, including the British government and the Bank of England, all of which predict economic damage. You remember how soon after the original vote, people were ringing me to tell me that they did know they were voting to be poorer. And that £350 million nonsense was one of the first fruits to wither upon the vine of reality, I would say. One of the first Brexit fruits to wither upon the vine of scrutiny. But the reason why all of these projections, forecasts, sums paint such a negative picture is because we did make a profit. Trade, every profit on every trade in a free market is a result of following the rules of that free market. And in our case, in the European Union, paying our dues as members. I don't even know whether it would have buttered any parsnips to point out that if we suffered an economic collapse in the style of, say, Greece, then we'd be rescued from oblivion. Although the medicine would in many cases be hard to swallow, we would be rescued from oblivion by our membership by dint of the fact that we'd paid money in. But, you know, the problem with that argument is that it confounds exceptionalism and lends itself to Project Fear rhetoric. And it's something I hadn't thought of before. We don't get any. So it's like paying insurance for 30 years. If we did suffer an economic collapse like the one Greece suffered at the turn of the last decade. And I don't think we will. I hope to God we don't. But I've just realised another downside of Brexit, which is that if you think about our membership fees as it, also being our insurance payments. So the European Central Bank, however it works, I'm not an expert on the mechanics of it, but you look at countries that have received, quotes, bailouts, end quotes. We've paid our insurance subs. What's the word when you pay your insurance? It's not subs, is it? Anyway, we've paid our insurance premiums. We've paid our insurance premiums for years and years and years. And the minute we leave, we're uninsured. Is that true? I'm thinking out loud on this one, so forgive me if I've got it wrong. But you know how bailout became a toxic word? I always wondered why that was. I think that was exceptional. Well, we'll never need a bailout. We'll never need a bailout. We'll never need a bailout. We're English. Rule Britannia. Britannia waives the rules. And hopefully we won't. Because if we do, we don't get it anymore, as I understand it. So we've paid decades of insurance premiums, and now we've torn up the policy, and we've got no insurance moving forward. That's what membership means. That's what cooperative means. That's what union can often mean. And here we are. Hallie's in Burnham. Sorry to keep you, Hallie. What would you like to say?
Hello. I think a lot of people have already said what I was going to say, James. I have heard people talking about signs on the continent,
yes,
explaining exactly where their money's coming from. I believe there was a couple in Wales at one time, but they never appear in England. And I think it's because we have to have rules from the councils or the government or something to say whether or not you can put such signs up. I don't think they've been allowed.
Would it have mattered?
Well, if you'd known that so much money was coming in that we were going to lose...
Yeah, but you know what I would say here, and I'm something of an expert in this bogus rhetoric, having been exposed to so much of it over the years, I would say, well, it's our money in the first place. We're giving them a ton of money, and they're just giving it some of it back so we can build a car park.
I believe that... Build a car park?
Well, yeah, all right, it was a figure of speech.
Yeah, well, come on, it's been for real stuff that... Welfare-type stuff.
I'm trying to sound like one of them. I'm trying to sound like one of them. The first thing you have to leave at the door. The ones that would have been anti-EU, they'd have said something like, build a car park. I was trying to sound like one of them, and now you're attacking me as if I was one of them.
Well, I'm attacking what you just said.
Yeah, fair enough. I withdraw.
Not you, I'm sorry.
No, I know. But that I don't know. We'll never know now, will we? You see,
no,
EU funds, here's one.
I don't know quite if you'd ever find out who didn't let them put the signs up, because we've had an awful lot of stuff. I don't know whether we've had more back than we've given, but I wouldn't be surprised.
Well, I mean, the problem, we won't have had...
four places in this country, yeah, not just Wales.
No, I know.
Parts of the north of England. We've got real poverty here in this country, but some of the other European countries with...
But I was pointing out what the response would be. No, I know, but I was just pointing out what the response would be. Because let me read you this from... This is the first paragraph of an article that was published on the 25th of June 2016 by the inimitable Carol Cadwallader. And this is her home turf. This is why she was so interested in how people from her own part of the world, her own part of Wales, had ended up voting against their own interests in such a spectacular fashion. Here's a wonderful paragraph that sums up what you've said. What's the EU ever done for us? Zach Kelly, 21, asks me this, standing next to a brand new complex of buildings and facilities that wouldn't look out of place in Canary Wharf. It's not Canary Wharf, though. It's Ebervale, a former steel town of 18,000 people in the heart of the Welsh Valleys, where 62% of the population, the highest proportion in Wales, voted leave. And there's a new dual carriageway there. There's a new sixth form and training college, a glass and steel architectural showpiece next to its new leisure centre, and nobody there knew.
No, that's what I'm sort of saying.
I know.
Why was there no big sign saying this came from the EU?
Well, you tell me, why do you think? I mean, there were some signs, and there are some signs, but why do you think we didn't put them up? I presume it's so that Westminster and or Cardiff,
yes,
and or Edinburgh could claim all the credit for themselves.
I would imagine so.
Yeah. It's a bit late now for us to work all this out.
All the Tory councils may actually give the rules, put the rules and make them take them down. I'm not sure who gives the rules for those sort of signs.
While simultaneously nursing Euroscepticism, it would be very difficult for local politicians, never mind national politicians, to advertise benefits of membership in any way whatsoever.
Exactly.
Oh, dear.
Well, there you go.
There you go.
Nice to talk to you, James.
Likewise, Hallie.
I think you said everything.
Well, I've got another 48 minutes of the programme to go, so I hope we haven't said absolutely everything. Here's one. Let me just... established where, no, it's not got a name on it, actually, but I'll read it out anyway. You are so rude to LBC callers who don't agree with you, O'Brien. I'm really not, you know, that they ring me up to insult me, and I try to keep things sweet, but some people are too furious to realise. You never allow any profession type of Brexiteer on your show to question what you say. Oh, I don't know what to do, really, except say 03456060973 is the number you need, whoever you are, wherever you're from. The question today is, how did it come to this? And I guess the most welcome call of all would be the caller saying, this is really good, this is what I wanted. And I do have to remind you, I will say, why? And that perhaps is an explanation of why the types you describe as not being allowed on are not ringing in. How did it come to this? And we put out a clip of my little message earlier after speaking to Ken, who was very, very cross with me for something apparently I said about food poverty and Brexiters. But he wasn't really cross about that. I can't think of anybody who was opposed to Marcus Rashford's free school meals campaign who wasn't also a massive fan of Brexit. But I think the words came from long before Marcus Rashford even got involved in politics. But I do, and I know I'm not the person at the moment to play this role. There's too much vitriol and too much history. And you know, I obviously, like anybody else, the abuse that one is exposed to from people that you're trying to help can be quite dispiriting. And I appreciate that the abuse needs to dial down, that anger needs to dial down. But we've put out a little clip of that message. If you know anyone in that category who has spent years doing a victory dance and is now waking up to reality, and I've got a horrible feeling they're going to end up with even more anger than they had when they went into the polling booth in 2016. And listen, I have broad shoulders and thick skin and all of the above. So I know the response is, I know you are, but what am I? So I say, why are these people so angry? And you say, oh, you're the angry one. Why can't you let it go? And I'm not, you see, that's the problem with that. But I get that you still need to say something in return. You can't just go, I think I'm going to go away and have a little think about this. You have to come back with your fists up. This genuinely is what my new book is about, because I was like that for almost all of my adult life. You have to keep fighting. You have to come out with your fists up. But it won't do you any good at all, because you've ended up being winning and still furious. Whatever happens in the next few days, it's going to be bad. Brexit was meant to make our lives better. Right? Especially if you bought into the metropolitan elite nonsense that was perpetrated by people like Jacob Rees-Mogg, who went to Eton. Put that on the list, will you? That's again something that really should have been a much louder alarm call than perhaps we registered it as being at the time. People who went to Eton describing people who didn't as being members of the metropolitan liberal elite. Quite incredible. But we are where we are. Very, very simply, you were promised an improvement to your life. That's just a fact. You were promised improvements to your life in every measurable area, in the short term, and hopefully not too long, hopefully the shortest of short terms. Another one for the list, when they started saying, we'll see the economic benefits in 50 years' time. Oh, okay, that's fine if you've got a few quid in the bank, but if you're already on Struggle Street, taking an economic hit for the next 50 years could be the difference between sinking and floating. So I fully understand that I am not the best person to be leading this quest, but I still want to be part of it. Hopefully somebody else can lead it. God knows who, though. But I still want to be part of it, because I hate seeing how angry and how bitter people are. And I hate the knowledge that they've been made that way. Nobody's born like that. Nobody's ended up like that by accident. It's a conscious and deliberate effort to enrage you with false information. So, for example, now you're supposed to get cross with the National Trust because it wants to put the history of a historic house in the actual historic house. So the same people that led you to this madness also want you now to be anti-history. The National Trust suggests it might start providing more information about the history of the house that you're actually in. And you don't have to reach far to find a Daily Telegraph columnist to say, well, if they want to find out the history of the house they've actually paid to visit, they should just buy a guidebook. I mean, how bonkers do you have to be to buy into that? And I'm afraid it's not confined to the comments section of the Daily Mail anymore, like it was when I started this job. It's basically the credo of the Conservative Parliamentary Party. It's full of people who believe this stuff. People who believe that if you give food vouchers to the parents of hungry children, they'll spend them in brothels and crack dens. This actually now gets said in public by politicians. This is what Brexit has done to us. Because until you acknowledge that they were wrong, I'm not even going to say lying, until you acknowledge that they were wrong, they will carry on. So you have huge objections to the fact that there's not going to be an audience sing-along at an event that doesn't have an audience. To go back to the last night of the proms, just stop and listen to my words, Ken and everybody like Ken. They're trying to make you angry about that now. There's no audience sing-along at an event that doesn't have an audience. They're publishing the history of a house in the actual house. Black Lives Matter is a Marxist movement that wants to defund the police, and everybody who believes that Black Lives Matter or that racism exists are somehow calling for a collapse of civilization. These are just lies. It's just not true. What have you done this week? Oh, I've been sticking up for the football fans that actually boo the anti-racist endeavours on the pitch. You've been doing what? I've been sticking up for the football fans that boo the anti-racist endeavours on the actual... Okay, right. And where did you stand on the Brexit vote? It's not exactly difficult to knit it together, is it? What have you been doing? I'm very, very opposed to feeding hungry school children during the school holidays. And how did you vote during the Brexit campaign? You see, they've just turned the anger that you were directing at Brussels, now that you are slowly waking up to the fact that Brussels didn't deserve any of that anger, they have to find new places to put it. Which is why they're telling you to get angry about there not being any audience sing-alongs at an event with no audience. It's why they're telling you that somehow British values are being undermined by actual history being published in an actual historic house. The history of the actual house. You see, surely, how low they hold you in their own regard if they think that you're that easy to manipulate. Cyclists. Could you imagine Nigel flipping Farage now talking about cycle lanes? The man who arguably did as much as anybody else to bring the entire country to the precipice of catastrophe, now getting paid by the Barclay brothers to wang on about cycle lanes? Are you going to let him do this to you? You're going to take the anger that was fermented over decades and directed towards our friends, neighbours and allies in Europe, and now you realise that that anger was built on lies and nonsense, you're going to transfer it, you're going to let them transfer it to cycle lanes and audience sing-alongs and historic houses and the National Trust and Black Lives Matter? You're going to end up sticking up for the actual racists in the crowd, booing the footballers who want to take a knee? God forbid they should do any public expression of a desire to eradicate racism. What else is on the list? Anything else on that list already yet? Because these will be the new bendy bananas, you see. These will be the new three-pin plugs. At first glance, they can sound funny or even harmless. But then they get into the bloodstream of the nation and 10, 15 years later, almost everybody believes arrant nonsense, utter gibberish, complete bilge. Boris Johnson has become Prime Minister on the back of a career dedicated to publishing bilge, to lying about what the European Union member... You never would have heard his name if he hadn't stumbled accidentally, having been fired from the Times for making up quotes from his own godfather and turning up on the Daily Telegraph, being sent to Brussels and stumbling upon a wonderful tactic for the Daily Telegraph readership that involved telling them lies about the European Union, selling them tickets for the ghost train, and then sitting back and counting the cash as everybody started screaming in horror and desperately trying to get out of the ghost train, where all the ghosts were made of papier-mâché and old egg boxes. And now we're here. We're right up against it. They're not going to say sorry to you, are they? They're going to tell you to start getting cross about footballers. They're not going to say sorry to you. They're not going to say we messed this up. they're going to start encouraging you to get angry with the National Trust. They're not going to say sorry to you. They're going to tell you that school meal vouchers get spent in crack dens and brothels. They're not going to say sorry to you. They're going to tell you that cyclists are the new enemy and that Black Lives Matter is some sort of... do you know what the best evidence is of the bogusness of that? Just ask them to name the people we should avoid. Next time you hear someone wanging on about Black Lives Matter while pretending that it's not actually the eradication of racism that they're spooked by, just ask them to name the people that we should avoid. So who is it then? Who are the fully paid up members and leaders of the Black Lives Matter movement? Because right now, I'm looking at people like the owner of Colchester publishing a really powerful piece about why he doesn't want season ticket holders in his ground if they're going to boo the Black Lives Matter protest, the Black Lives Matter moment. Who are the leaders of this incredibly powerful group that is dedicated to dismantling democracy? Yeah, you see? They still treat you like idiots. They still think you're dumb. A little bit of xenophobic stoking, a little bit of poking, a little bit of provoking. And they'll just move your fury from Brussels and the European Union and Angela Merkel and Michel Barnier. They'll move it from there and they'll stick it somewhere else. And it'll be just as dishonest. It'll be just as damaging and it'll be just as dangerous. But do you know what? They'll get richer. They'll get more famous. They'll get more pats on the back off the billionaires that own the newspapers that they write for while the whole country is unnecessarily and avoidably led into decline. And the final thing they'll do, those of us who mourn what we've lost, we're the ones that don't love our country enough, you see. Those of us who point at the bruises and say, why have we done this to ourselves? We're the ones that don't love ourselves enough. Those of us who point with laser-like clarity to every single thing I've just described to you as an appalling assault upon and affront to British people, British values and British history, they will accuse us of not being patriotic. And it's up to you, and it's up to Ken, and it's up to every single one of us to decide whether we're going to let them get away with it again. I'll take bets on whether or not you think this text is tongue-in-cheek or not, but here it goes. I can't believe you were allowed to, because remember I said to you, all that will be left is, I know you are, but what am I? I can't believe that you're allowed to broadcast your fear-mongering and woke values. All you seek to achieve is division, just as I describe to you how the people that sold you the Brexit con will now seek to move on to other stuff because the alternative would be to embrace reality, acknowledge their mistakes and, of course, apologise. The reason why I thought that might be tongue-in-cheek was because they've added a PS. I do love Mystery Hour. 12:37 is the time. Juniper is in Adderbury. Juniper, what the hell happened?
Okay, so I just wanted to, I used to work in European Affairs, so oh, yes. I used to bid for funding to run projects and to fund capital projects and also to obviously run revenue projects. So the capital projects obviously would be kind of big things like broadband or maybe building an art centre or a training centre. And the revenue projects would be mostly helping unemployed people or people who needed to be reskilled back into work. So with the capital projects, it was absolutely a contractual obligation that you had to put a label and it had to be a certain size and it had to be at least the same size as other funders on your project. So you know how sometimes you see architects...
Yes. I know exactly what you mean.
So we would always put our logo, the European Commission logo, European Community logo, on those signs, along with probably the local authority that's also funding it or anyone else. Or the regional development agency in those days. And then on revenue projects, which would be helping unemployed people back into work, the logo would be on absolutely every single piece of documentation. And so all projects, if there was publicity, the logo would have to be there. Now, my feeling about some of the discussion that's gone forward so far is I think as a as a community, we just don't read those things.
So it was there. That I'm being sent some pictures, and on every single thing. So you wouldn't be able to do less
every single project
on in England than you would in Greece. The rules would be
exactly
the same. How
and
bizarre!
We would audited by the European Commission.
Yes.
And that would be one of the first things that they needed to see on every single thing, that it had their logo alongside, at the time, the Regional Development Agency. Sometimes you see it, the DWP, sometimes, which is the Department of Work and Pensions. Sometimes you see the local authority. And sometimes if there's a private sector sponsor, that would also go on there. And
what's your theory then on why, you know, even I am surprised to learn this. I don't for a minute doubt what you're telling me, but in my mind, I remember seeing it in other countries and I don't remember seeing it in my own.
Okay, so in the UK,
yeah,
the majority of actions in the majority of the country would be revenue projects. So unless you were a beneficiary of that project, i.e. you've been out of work and you were being retrained, you wouldn't see it. Now, at the moment, it's really interesting, actually. I think it's quite funny. There are two logos in places where I kind of go regularly.
Yes.
One is in Burford in Oxfordshire,
yes.
And in the high street, and they've only just appeared since coronavirus, so it's been this year.
Right.
They have put these signs saying, keep your distance. And it's funded by West Oxfordshire Council,
right,
and the European, that one is the European Regional Development Fund. And then there's another one in Cockermouth in Cumbria,
yeah,
on the, you know, the broadband boxes on the street, the green ones,
yes,
which have the connections with your phone and everything. It's on there and it says Rural Development Fund, European Rural Development Fund, funded this broadband connection.
Okay.
So those are there now and they both appeared since the referendum. I mean,
not
obviously
before.
The one in Burford, the distancing.
Of course, couldn't have been. And then there's much bigger stuff where we probably did have the signs, like the,
yes,
infrastructure projects in Ebbervale, and still,
yes,
they
exactly
returned a 64% leave vote. Just,
yes,
I mean, you've given us the detail and the fact. Can I tempt you into a little bit of speculation? Why? I mean, Mark in East Ham, I need to just apologise for something he said about Catholics, actually. I do. I'm being serious. When he suggested that me being a Catholic was a reason to hate on me, is obviously that is an incitement to religious hatred. We let it pass because the tone of the conversation was, I felt at least, was warmish. But obviously, if that did upset you, then I am a Catholic and I do go to church. So please don't think that I have in any way underestimated or overlooked how hurt and offended you may have been by what Mark in East Ham said earlier about Catholics. But back to Juniper, because he did make some good points about. Well, he blamed it on the EU for failing to shout from the rooftops how much good they did. I think from a personal perspective, he felt that he should have been told more about the good that they did. How do you rationalise what's happened, given that it is, and always was, if you took the trouble to look, obvious that membership had lots and lots of benefits? Why do you think so many people were so unaware of them?
I think that actually as a community, we're ashamed of, we were ashamed of being in Europe and we didn't want to be, and particularly...
Isn't that a bit chicken and egg, though? Do you think the shame came before the fibs and the embellishments, or the embellishments and the fibs created the shame?
I mean, I think you should... I mean, things like Big Pit in Wales...
Yeah.
There's a couple of things in, the National Maritime Museum down in Cornwall.
Yes.
They've been funded by it, and I think they're quite proud of it because they see that as being a real kind of step forward. But I think in the main, we don't want to recognise the fact that we needed help. And so, for example, Wales got a much higher intensity. They used to, it's called Objective One, which means the really poor regions like Greece, they got this very high intensity of infrastructure funding, and so did Cornwall. But the majority of Britain is kind of doing okay.
Now.
And so we would really, yeah, but we kind of, yes, but I mean, I'm only talking about the last 20, 30
yes.
years in which I was working.
Sure.
The majority of Britain was doing okay, so it would be hidden subsidies through the government to fund our training programs for unemployed people, or to help small businesses. That was another one. Lots of small business funding to help startups or to help businesses grow, particularly in key sectors.
What do you think the future looks like?
I think the future looks dreadful. I mean, I can't even. I feel like a prisoner. I can't even express it.
And I suspect that those who are reveling in your Remainer tears are feeling, many of them are feeling very silly today. Although, of course, the ones with the loudest voices will still be either claiming that they enjoy the discomfort that's being visited upon the country as a result of their own choices and decisions, or that somebody like Juniper doesn't really understand what Brexit is about or what EU membership represented. And I will take a moment. I'm feeling very charitable, actually. I've got a horrible feeling this is going to be my new shtick, isn't it, for the next few months. Ben in Gloucestershire has been in touch to accuse me of misinformation. He says, we pay £350 million a week to go into the car boot sale and we lose £100 billion per year, brackets, trade deficit, brackets. OK, I'll try again, Ben, and this might help. Imagine that £200 profit that you make by dint. So you pay 50 quid for your pitch, right? And then you make a £200 profit, and then you go and spend £300 elsewhere in the car boot area. You would have 300 quid's worth of kit and a trade deficit with your own stall. Do you see why that those words don't mean what you think they mean? Or do I have to have another crack? Because I'm happy to. I really am, and I really will. My biggest fear, I suppose, is that people don't want to understand what they've done because the guilt would be unbearable. And Chris expands upon a theme we've been exploring this morning. He says that in Hungary, Orbán benefits from huge EU funding. There are massive building projects, but the EU label is tiny. His photo, and thanks to Fidesz, his party, is massive. He uses EU funding to further his own position, and Hungary teeters ever closer to textbook fascism, actually. What's happened to the media there in recent years is genuinely breathtaking. But it's a valid point that you make. 12:49 is the time. Why did this happen? How did this happen? How would you explain it? And I have stressed throughout, you are welcome to say, I'm glad this is happening. This is what I wanted all along. This is great. Deal or no deal, you're going to be chuffed. Slightly throwaway gag earlier in the week when I said it must be awful not to know yet what you're going to have to spend the rest of your life pretending that you definitely voted for. So I'll give you two things. You could say, I definitely voted for the abolition of the freedom of movement, which means you'll have to explain to your children why they have the freedom to move between two countries and their French cousin has the freedom to move between 27. How's that a win for us? On what possible pitch does 27-2 sound like good news for the team that scored two? Yeah. Well, that was what I thought as well. And Charlotte says that she needs a little bit of help dealing at Christmas in particular with people around her in her family who will talk about sovereignty and independence and hating the EU. Can you give me a neat two-sentence summary that I can use for my in-laws and other family members when it comes up over Christmas? I think I can, actually. I would say that abiding by WTO rules involves a surrendering of sovereignty, but we have a lot less say over what those rules will be than we did over what the EU rules were. And I would also say that any pooling of resources, whether it is Wellington and the Prussians at the Battle of Waterloo, or whether it is simple modern-day membership of NATO, involves a surrendering of sovereignty. Or, depending on how punchy you're feeling, Charlotte, just ask them to define sovereignty and then keep those two little caveats and responses in the locker. So just say, what do you mean by that? And we were one of the major players in the making of the rules. Margaret Thatcher, widely regarded as the architect of the single market that we're now leaving. And then just when you think things can't get any madder, you stumble across the truly ridiculous Gisela Stewart talking to Sky News yesterday and actually in public uttering the words which I've now lost, but I will find them shortly. Gisela Stewart actually uttering the words about essentially saying, oh, well, we had no idea that the European Union would be so stringent in its protection of the single market. What did you have in your ears for the entire referendum debate. And I think, is she one of the ones that's in the House of Lords now? It's almost as if, I thought this was a trolling exercise, it's almost as if they took the worst offenders, the biggest boneheads, and stuck them in the House of Lords just to stick it to the Ramonas. Gary's in Paris. Gary, what would you like to say?
Well, good morning, James. I've been listening to your programme now for sort of the best part of 4 years since the vote, and getting increasingly desperate when I hear people phoning up, calling people who voted against Brexit Ramonas and prophets of doom. And, I mean, it's absolutely ridiculous. I mean, I actually run a company here, a French company which exports to the UK. There's about 30%. Of our foreign export to the UK, and it's right. An important market for us. And at the moment, we've set up a Brexit task force to try and plan for the worst possible scenario, obviously, which will be a no deal. And everything that we look at in terms of extra cost, extra hassle, with customs declarations, to VAT being paid on stuff. I mean, it's just, the more we get into it, the more of a nightmare it is. And at the moment, I'm having a real hard time seeing what the upside of Brexit is for anybody in the UK, because not only are they going to have to pay for the eventual consequences of this, but also I'm thinking about any UK company that wants to develop or continue to develop in Europe. They're going to have exactly the same problems coming the other way. And it's the more we get into it, the more we peel the onion back, the more things we discover.
I'm glad you've got the humility to say that, because I'm surprised. The problem is, when you start off from a position that this is bad and you discover that it's actually much worse than you realised, it involves a degree of humility to own up to it. And I hope that becomes almost an invitation to other people that voted the other way. Because you could say, Gary and I both thought Brexit was a bad idea, but we had no idea how bad. And that makes it a bit easier, hopefully, for people to say, well, I thought Brexit was a good idea, but I had no idea how bad.
Correct.
Or am I being naive? I'm being a bit. Well, I have to be optimistic.
No, I think that the whole point is that what it illustrates is that when the vote was taken, there was a massive dearth, a real lack of real understanding about what the implications of this would be.
And on every side, that, on every
on
side,
every,
yes.
On every side, exactly.
For sure.
And then I think so. Everyone took the vote really with not having all of the information at their disposal. And but the problem is that when you've also got politicians at a higher level basically pumping out nonsense in many cases, half truths, then how do you expect people to make an informed decision about how they vote?
I honestly didn't, I don't, and that's why compassion for the conned is such a huge part of where I am now, because contempt for the con men, and some of the con men didn't even know. Well, this is the big discovery for me, if we're making a list of things we didn't realise until quite recently.
So, remember when Dominic Raab stood up and said that he didn't understand how important the Calais-Dover route was export and import traffic.
But he remains convinced that Brexit, having discovered how important it is, he remains convinced that Brexit is a good idea.
Yeah.
That's the weird bit, right?
Sums it up.
Doesn't it just? Well, I'm glad you're still chuckling. I mean, it's a big chunk out of your business, but you will just move your business in a different direction, will you?
Well, no, because I mean, and this is possibly where Brexiters, they're right in some respects, is that we haven't spent 10 years developing a business in the UK with as much energy and determination as we have just to throw in the towel now. We're clearly going to carry on doing what we need to do to develop a business because it's a good opportunity. However, the amount of adaptation and flexibility that we have to show to get around it. I mean, and just an example of the complexity. I mean, we're going to ship into the UK, but then, of course, you've got the other side, which is we have customers in Northern Ireland and Southern Ireland. Mm. So you're going back out of the UK into the European Union again. I mean, you put all that complexity in. We've got to handle it. We've got to work around it. But the costs involved, I mean, to us, we're talking about hundreds of thousands of euros of on cost potentially if there's no deal, because we're talking about world trade or tariffs going on top of the product.
Of course.
So it's hard, and it's a real it's a real bind, but we've got to work around it.
And of course, if you work around it, some people will trumpet your relative success as a vindication of their vote. But what you're describing is actually damage limitation. We want to stay in the game. We know that the game is not going to be as lucrative or as beneficial as it was, but hopefully we'll still be able to get some sort of result from the new rules and the new well, yeah, playing
but
field.
But again, I mean, it's going to affect how many people we employ in the UK. We would have liked to employ, we've employed more people, but we would have employed a lot more. The fact is that we've got to get our costs under control, so we can't just keep investing in people, and that's going to cost UK jobs. So you know, that just in our little world, and then you multiply that over how many companies, it's clearly going to have effect on the UK economy.
And survival then becomes vindication, and that's the really scary bit, which is why it's so helpful for Gary to remind us that we were promised that our lives would get better. Every aspect of our life. We'd have 350 million quid for the NHS, remember? So, by way of conclusion, two front pages for you. One from November of 2018 and one from December of 2000. Both in the Daily Telegraph. November 2018, Carney unleashes Project Hysteria. Okay, you remember that? Fast forward 2 years to December of 2020, to this very week, no less, and you have food rots and factories shut as port chaos hammers UK. And I lean towards the reports in the newspapers that told you Brexit was going to be brilliant for the reports of what the reality actually looks and feels like. But I mean it. I know I'm not yet the person who can achieve this because of all the water that's gone under the bridge, but there will be a soft landing space for you. There will be warmth and sympathy when you realise what a terrible, terrible mistake you were persuaded to make by politicians who will be a million miles away from the trouble when it finally begins to bite.
I can see the buzzards, I can hear the crows, one more minute to go, and now I'm swinging and here I am.